So we are starting the case. Coil and glue.
घबराइए कुछ नहीं होगा.
Let us sit it.
That is a huge.
You use C arm. You don't use C arm.
I don't use C arm.
I always use C arm.
Okay. So we have two experts with us. They don't use C arm for putting in a coil and glue injection. Okay.
So, but usually I'll do a coil, especially in a large braces, with CT scan and awareness about the size of the shunt. I need to be sure that the shunt is not very large for me to be going in and putting in the balloon. Especially the gastrorenal shunts can be a troublesome feature when we are doing this.
So we will see as we go in and decide.
Yeah, we'll see that.
Because our patient in this part of country, we often do not have CT scan and MR.
Okay.
What about you, Ravi? Always?
I always.
Always CT and MR.
Contrast and CT is a must. For me, I always use a C arm also.
Okay, you always use a C arm also. So we will fit in the C arm. If it is to just to show how it looks like. Coil.
So this patient had a bleeding.
This patient had bleed. He has spondyl varices. So what we are seeing now?
Seeing a portal vein.
We are seeing the pancreas, the portal vein, and the superior mesenteric vein forming the portal vein in a group posterior to the pancreas.
So for the introduction to the audience, what you are saying is, so what Dr. Wadhwa said is that this is superior mesenteric vein and this is the
portal vein.
Okay. We have some higher gain, so while we reduce the gain a little bit, okay.
We can show the inferior mesenteric vein also joining the junction of the splenic vein and the superior mesenteric vein.
Somewhere here?
Yes.
Okay.
You can see that.
Okay. So, since we are discussing the portal hypertension part, how to see the confluence, I would like to add on, Dr. Wadhwa. I call it the union five territories. And we will show it in some other case. But right now, five means this is superior mesenteric vein, splenic vein, portal vein, inferior mesenteric vein, and left
gastric vein.
Yeah. Okay, but please let us see how do you see spondyl varices?
You can see the another vein coming into the splenic vein there.
Okay. So we wish to go toward the spondyl side. This is the Now this is what Dr. Wadhwa wanted to point out. Am I right?
Yes.
So this is the left gastric vein joining the. I'll call you. Okay.
The liver here. Actually, this we are primarily looking at the portal anatomy. We would like to see the thing in the fundus, portal vein in the fundus, which will be. Can we see here?
So right now we have colletus. The only problem is we have to be sure that these colletus are in the submucosa.
Submucosal area, yeah.
How to make sure? That is a difficult part.
I try to look at the muscularis propria and anything which is anterior to muscularis propria. Will help me to. Can you show the muscularis propria here?
I would say, means
here.
This is. So, Dr. Praveer, can you change and add on with this? Dr. Praveer, could we please change and come join us. So Dr. Praveer has also done a lot of, yeah, give him an aprin, just give an aprin and let him
join. Here you can see the perforators also and the paragastric varices also here.
So you see, what do you mean by perforator?
Perforators are the veins which probably go, go from the submucosal space across the muscularis propria into the perigastric area.
So we are trying to assess portal aptation. Till now we have said that there is a confluence. We see the portal vein, sphere mesenteric vein, splenic vein, portal vein. We see patency of portal vein. And then we see the collaterals. How do they flow? Okay. And you are seeing collaterals. Once we see the collaterals, the job is to identify whether they are outside the
muscularis propria or inside the muscularis propria.
Inside the muscularis. So this one, do you think this is... This one is inside the
this is outside. This one. No, these are submucosal.
But not 2 years. 2 centimeters tak aana chahiye na. Zoom should come to 2 centimeters. Zoom is coming only to 4 centimeters. You get my point? Dr. Vadva, I have another trick.
Yeah, tell me.
Once you see,
I'm always open to learning from you.
See, this, what we are seeing right now is, as you said, that these are the varics. If I find the muscular layer curving like this, that means that this is submucosal. And then I will put in some water in this position.
Sir.
Can I have the water?
We need to put water into the stomach. Now patient is not intubated.
Agreed. Yeah, small amount of. Small amount, not too much. So
somehow I always think.
Yes, agreed. But we live in slightly different circumstances. We have learned to. Baba, you also.
No, I normally, all the patients, I don't intubate. But suppose if patient has a recent bleeding, there's a large amount of blood in the stomach, then probably that will be the time when I will prefer to intubate.
So the what, can we zoom it now? Just for a second. We are changing the setting because we wanted to zoom this a little bit more. US. Understood? So we have this.
And normally, I inject a little bit more water in the stomach.
Yes.
That's one reason why I wanted.
So because you have the luxury of injecting more water.
Yeah. And.
बच्चों की कलोनी कॉपी की तैयारी करो. Okay, we will do after the case. Why it is fixed at 4?
Yes, sir. Okay, now you are saying something about the movement of muscularis propria across the...
So the thing what I want to show is that this is the movement of muscularis propria is like this. This is the curving part. I will probably put the scope a little bit more in. And here is where I would like to see this part of air is trapping here. Some part of air. We need to totally suck all the air out, and then we see. Also, probably do what wise, because in this case, I am used to yes, right, right. This is what we want. This is what we are seeing. This is what we are seeing here. This is see, this sort of coil. This muscular is probably doubling up. So the varices is hanging now on itself. Can we just restart it, reprobe? So the struggle, the second struggle what we have is in finding the vessel and in locating it for the proper position. So I would like to give you my share of tricks, okay? Because okay, so, but I see this is inverted.
This is inverted. That's why I'm
yeah. Difficult. We are back in the stomach.
You do the cranial and on the left side, you know. Yours, Malaysia, have it.
No, both. I can manage both ways. So, can I use my trick if you don't? If you would allow me,
sure.
Okay,
please go.
So what I do, Adva, is You found it, but I would like to also to show my trick. You already found it. Number one, I would request you to do the Adva. Is why generally is I am relax myself, and I in such a way, and then I rotate it likewise toward the fundus, and then in the I stand. I move my body already like this. I don't want to stand. With this, I move my body in like this, and then just I relax. What I find now is that this varix is now hanging like this, and this is the varix I want. So instead of holding, so if you feel comfortable with this position, yeah, so this is a little bit awkward for many people, but somehow it gives a very good view of the fundal varix.
Yeah, so I reach usually by anti-clockwise rotation of my hand.
Yeah,
in the same manner.
So the reason I don't want to, sir. In this case, now what I was saying is the varix is now curving. It is curling, and we will now measure the varix. What is the size of the varix diameter? So this is the size of the varix. The size.
What is the coil?
So we are trying to. You feel happy with the varix now?
Yeah. I think this we can take into the suitable. You can see that they are submucosal, proven to be submucosal. They are large varices. So I would like to measure each of the segment and then plan the coil accordingly. Anything you would like to add?
See, I would like to just add you that this is just one varix only.
Correct. I agree.
So this is here, this is one varix, and there are multiple coils. So I want to calculate how many loops are there. Can you calculate how many loops are there?
I normally would like to see the amount in
one, two, three, four, five, six. I would say around 7 or 8 loops are there.
Yeah.
So and what is the diameter is the second thing we have to calculate. This is 1.2
centimeters.
Okay.
Smaller one.
Yeah. No, we'll prefer 18 millimeters. 18 millimeters. Yeah. Deepak, anything.
Yes, ideally, yes, because if you directly go into the efferent vessel, you are likely to have the embolization much higher. So it is better to trace the afferent and efferent vessel and then try to inject in. It is preferable to go in afferent rather than efferent vessel.
So we would like to probably make it a little bit darker.
Okay.
Which coil?
Normally, since it's more than 1 centimeter, I like to use an ester coil. The choice I prefer to have is 20% more than the diameter of the varex. So suppose if it is 1.2, I definitely would like to have more than 16 millimeter as the diameter.
20 millimeter.
That will be fine, but it should be 20 to 40% of the diameter of that.
So if it's 12 millimeter, you will be comfortable with 14.
18 millimeter is also there.
We will place 21.
Yeah, okay. Sure.
We will open up. So this time I will shift my stand because my assistants are here.
Yeah, this maybe you can show the load of the coil in the.
Now, second thing is, you would like your assistant to point from this side, or you would
prefer to him to have a direct thing? Because more the angulation, the more difficult it will be for subsequent glue injection.
Okay, subsequent glue injection. So we have everything ready. What do you want ready? What are the steps?
See, whenever I prepare this, of course, I need a multiple size of the coils which should be present.
How many do you want?
Here, at least three, minimum three, probably more than that, if required. Okay. The three of these will be going into the larger of the three segments, and then small amount of glue can be injected, which will probably clot the entire.
We have the needle. Can we have the, which needle we have?
We will need a 19 gauge needle because we are using a proper nester coils.
So this is a 19 gauge Boston Scientific needle.
Yeah.
Okay.
I prefer to load the coil before introducing the needle in.
Okay.
We can show the loading of the coil here and then we can go back in.
So you want to load the coil first? All three
yes.
together or one?
No,
by one?
One by one. We have what?
I will hold it.
Yeah.
You show the loading.
Okay. We have what we use it as a nester coil. There are actually three words on this nester coil. One is it starts with 35 or 25 based on the diameter with which the needle can be used. You may have 35. It is 35 is used to be with the 19 gauge needle. Then you have the next word, which could be either 7, 10, 14, 16, or 18. The second word which is there is indicates the length of the coil. And the third or the last, which is 20 here, could be anywhere between 14, 16, 18, and 20. This is the diameter of the coil. And it is here what we are looking at, the diameter of the coil. These three words are important because what needle you are choosing, what coils you are choosing. If you are choosing a 22 gauge needle to put it in a small varex, then you choose a micro nester coil and not the conventional nester coil. Here, this is a nester embolization coil. When you load the needle, you take out the can you take this or steel it? You have the loaded coil in a needle here, which needs to be attached to the You can attach. I'll just tell them you keep attached.
The coil is inside the needle.
The coil is inside the needle. As it's a long coil, you can see the needle. The coil needs to be fixed here to the needle. And then
you use a
steel head. You use a steel head to push the coil into the lumen of the needle. It should be easy and smooth flow. Once you have pushed it, that's all. You take away the needle out. And take the needle out. Now you can push back the steelette and push the coil in the needle. Make sure that it was a 14 centimeter coil, so you don't push the steelette right till the end, otherwise you are going to push the coil out. leave about 20 centimeters of the stelae behind when you are pushing in the needle, and then you can load the needle onto the scope. Malay, you can take this. Okay. Take it.
No.
Attach it. No problem.
I will. So the only thing I wanted to show few more things before I give it back, because in the meantime that we are seeing,
yeah,
I tried to find where is exactly the perforator. So I rotated my body clockwise and anti-clockwise, and I tried to identify that all these varices till now appear submucosal to me, because but at least here this varices at one place seems to be going out of the muscularis, and this is where I can see this is the muscularis, and I am tracing where exactly is the muscularis. This is the muscularis, this is still the muscularis. Somewhere this varices has to go out of. So this probably is where still I would mostly at this particular phase, because I can see this is the air. So this is the doubling up. There are double muscularis here. So this is the safe. This is definitely the varices. This probably is the extragastric or paragastric perforator. This is the place where it is perforating, and these are the definite submucosal varices. This is doubling up of muscular layer, and within this doubled up muscular layer you can see the presence of air. So before I miss Vadwa, I one question.
Yeah,
you want to go all the way here, or yeah, you want to stay here?
I would prefer to go all the way down and then come back up.
Yes. So you agree with me that we want to now go all the way down from here? Which varices?
Yes. You know, come.
This one, this or this one?
No, that one we will
prefer. Yeah. This one, agree with
me? Yeah, yeah.
So this is the one you want. Okay. So the advantage with this one is that you can put in one and in this, and then
draw it back and then, yeah, put second one.
Okay.
So we are, because if I put proximally, then probably the you know, the vision distally may not become as good. So I would go to into the distal one first, and then put the second thing into the proximal one.
No problem. Transmission.
Can you just adjust it?
So. Lock.
So when do you, Manoj, when do you load the coil? Before
I learned this trick from Dr. Vadwa just now. I don't preload the coil. So this is, thank you, Dr. Vadwa. And this is an interesting trick, but I will show you what are the advantages of my trick also. But
you hold it like this.
You want me to hold the scope for you? If any
push? That will be good if you can.
Acha, okay. So I will hold the scope. Yeah. Okay. So we are in.
Now we can just push the coil out. Can you push the coil out? You can see the coil coming out now and getting rotated in the varices.
Oh, that's fantastic. So don't use color.
As of now, no. We use later.
Oh, later. Great.
What we can do is, once you have pushed it, just take the needles so that the last of the coil drops into the lumen of the varices. We can use the second coil now. We can load the second coil and go and put the second coil in another loop.
You want for the needle, blood will not come back?
No, it should not.
Okay. So that is another trick I want. Blood comes back, and I was getting worried, and I was flushing it with a little bit of saline. But Dr. Vadwa says that the blood need to come back, so we will see. So these are the practical problems that we anticipate.
Even and if blood comes, it's okay. We are using a stelae to push it in.
So these, yeah, Dr. Ravi said even if blood comes back, it's okay, no problem.
Okay, using a stelae to push it will go sometimes. If you are using saline to push the coil, then it may not
work. So the check-in trick we learned from expert Dr. Ravi just told me, even if blood come, it's okay, because this is not going to coagulate within the period that we have, and we should be able to push in the second coil. And you see, this is a 20 millimeter coil, but this is adjusted between the lumen nicely. Oh, so that is good. So you have another coil in place. But this is getting difficult now. Yeah, but doesn't matter. It moved from one varix to another varix, I believe.
Yeah. Now I think I'll just use a small amount of glue to clot this. You can use a Doppler here to show the reduction in the flow of the blood, but it is still present. It's not completely obliterated.
So can we add agitated saline or water you want to, just to show something?
I will use a saline.
Saline, normal saline, agitated. Why I want to agitate is because remove the color Doppler and I will show the bubbles going. Just we'll shake some air inside it and we'll just show that it is going. Confirm that this is inside the varix. Just we will push in 1 ml of air, put in some amount of water, agitate it so that the bubbles are mixed and then should have been ready. Then we will show this is going inside the.
It is a distal coil, lot of thrombus has formed.
Yeah. So we are sure now that this is this part. So the you want to put in now glue?
Yes.
Okay. We are ready now with the glue injection.
So if you use a glove, then we cannot use a coil in the same.
You want to put in more coil? No need.
I think we should be able to close
I
it.
I think we have no need. These
we
two
don't
coils
need
are already fantastic. Yeah.
Most of the vein is
1 ml glue, 2 ml glue.
1 ml.
Vadva is comfortable with 1 ml glue only.
Yes. Now you have already.
We don't use Lipidol at our center.
Now, if blood is there, glue will find it difficult to go through.
No, you have already used the saline here. Yes. This is the time when we use
it. So we're using a saline to wash out whatever blood in the needle so that the glue goes inside. So if you don't do that, the blood will make the passage of glue more difficult.
So we should have done saline first. Again, Dr. Ravi pointed out that the glue will not go if you had not put in saline. Now we put in the glue and then you have pushed in the water. And the view becomes bad because then you lose everything.
Can you put the Doppler once again? And you can see the complete obliteration of the varix there. You are not seeing anything. And we gradually withdraw the needle, thereby completing the process here. There's a small flow still left, but I think we have done fairly okay job here.